We'll start off with the good ones, and then, I mean, the what I call the boring ones, but the ones that are for the children and the family to hear. And then by the end of the hour here, I'm sure the liquid courage will kick in, and the stories you'll hear will turn to rambling stories. There goes Mr. Bill Chandler walking by. I see Debbie Morrow there. She's going through the old photographs. There's a big table of old photographs of Doug and the family out here. And speaking of family, I saw Kathy. Kathy's my age and went to school with me early in the days, you know, from grammar school up. And then we called her Strawberry. If you remember Kathy, Garen, we called her Strawberry. Apparently because of her hair, she had the dirty strawberry blonde hair. And Amanda, you remember that?
Man, she was fine with she was fine.
I'm going to ask you to quit looking out the window.
Sorry. I'm not looking at the window. You fool. Look here. I'm not looking at the window. I'm hungry.
Okay, well, we'll bring you a corn chip. I think they have corn chips over here for you.
Well, I got this candy in here that gave me diarrhea. I'm going to try it.
Yeah. Well, I see Kathy over there, and I see Doug's brother, Pat. Pat Guerin's over here, and him and Kathy are the only two family members I know that are here that I've seen so far. I see Amy Jones wandering over there, and lots of folks I see their names. I mean, see their faces, and I have to try to remember the name. I think I saw Steve Lewis over there earlier. And I'm kind of, I think I see Randy Fox. He's over here wandering around. I see Randy over here. He's been involved with a lot of stuff. And, of course, Ron, I think, was already telling the stories. I couldn't hear, but I think he was saying he was telling the stories about what he remembered of Doug. And, now I'm over here doing what I'm supposed to do, and we're just waiting on folks to come over here and talk as we were instructed. So, they obviously don't realize it's like going to a show or anything else, or a high school dance. Not that people drank in high school, but, I might have to get Ron. You know, Ron's a radio guy. He knows how you gotta encourage guys to get up, and I'm trapped in my old seat. I gotta get folks to come over here and start talking, or I'm just gonna be sitting here telling stories. I was telling the story about Doug, he took me up shooting a .22 rifle when I was probably 10, you know, and just by myself. Just, hey, Mr. Bro Daddy, I'm going to take, there goes Larry Morgan. We'll get him up, and then I see he's headed through the back. And he was like, hey, can I borrow a gun, a .22, and a box of shells, and I'll take your son out hunting, shooting up in the mountains. Well, sure, Doug. Just have him back my supper, you know, and somehow I'm still alive and never lost an eye. And I have two arms and two legs.
But did you learn how to shoot a rifle?
I already knew how. I think that was Doug's way of getting a free box of shells.
Okay, all right.
But we got Joe Cade out here. I don't know, Joe, you know, he might have a story he wants to tell. I'm just trying to ramble up here. I have Bill Chandler. I'm seeing who I can see when they're coming in, if they have a story they remember about Doug. But we're going to start off with maybe the family kind of stories and the good stories. You know, like, well, I went and remember from school. And then we'll get in after they've had a few drinks. We'll get into the stories about how they, you know, went skinny dipping and shot the guy at the Church of God with the fountain when he came to throw them out. Things like that. But I see Amy Jones Banks over there, attorney Richard Banks' wife. She's here. Of course, she grew up in the neighborhood there on the corner of Harrell and 21st. They're in the Jones house, which is still controlled by a Jones family member, right next to Fro Daddy's house. And, on the, just straight down the road on Harrell Avenue is where Doug Guerin, grew up.
But, did he ever tell, I'm gonna tell you what he told me one time, Fro Daddy. He said he thought that Joe's mother was one of the prettiest ladies in the world.
Well, he was a little old pervert.
Yeah, but I'm saying, and he just loved your mother. He did. He thought highly of her.
Yeah. And my mother thought highly of you till you told people that she put me on a leash and she banned you from the radio. So
she hadn't called back since, has she?
No, she's not going to.
Well,
you have a way of ruining a good party, Matador. Do you know that?
Are you saying I mess a wet dream up?
By the way, you ruined one of our batteries. We had to throw it away. So if we go dead before the end of the cast, it's your fault, by the way.
Oh, did I ruin the battery?
Yeah, you win it. There goes one of the other Jones boys. I see Bailey Jones headed into the bistro, sneaking in back door. I might get Larry Morgan over here in a minute. He might have a story. If anybody has a story about Doug growing up, a childhood story, family story, I'm going to try to get him on the radio live. That's what we're doing today. Mm-hmm. And if that doesn't work, I'm going to get Daniel just to read some biography or something out of the menu of the Hey, Tim Rogers in the house. He might have a story. You got a story about Doug Gearing? Nobody wants to talk to me. Maybe Bill Chandler. You know, Bill Chandler lives on the Chandlers live on Harrell Avenue now. Now, they didn't live in that house growing up. That was like, I believe that was one of the Harrell family homes. But Bill might, he might have a story about Doug Gearing, or he might just be here for the free cold beer. I'm not sure what he's doing for me.
Okay, brother man. Who you got there?
Oh, Tim's telling me. Come here and tell me a story, Tim. I can't get anybody. Well, I ain't neither. There's Randy Fox. Hey, Randy, you got a story about Doug you want to tell us about? You got a story you want to tell real quick? Oh, yeah. I see what everybody's doing. They're coming for the free beverages.
Now, don't do that, Fro Daddy. They don't want to talk to you, Fro Daddy. You got them nervous.
That's what I'm talking about. I don't have them nervous.
Fro Daddy, will you tell me what kind of sandwiches they have?
No, there's none for you. They said you're not welcome.
Well, listen, I'm the man. I'm coming in, and I'm turning some chairs over to get to them sandwiches.
Well, maybe you should come. Maybe you need to come over here and start causing a ruckus.
Well, I am. You better call the NAACP, because I'm going to come over, bro.
You haven't been thrown out of the bistro since you got fired. Man, it's time for you to get thrown out again.
Well, it's about time. Then I'll be good to go for another year.
Hey,
Marco Polo!
I'm going to let him matter.
Marco Polo!
All right, then.
Okay.
Well, I see Charlie, one of our, what do you call them? What matter who those people that serve you warrants, what do you call those guys? Constables?
It's the Constability.
Charlie's over there, you know Charlie.
Yeah.
He's over here, he's wandering around. Now, he might have a story about Doug. I can't get anybody to get up and wander over. They're all too busy drinking and eating and partying and talking.
Well, I'm going to have to come out there and give you a hand. I'll be there in a minute.
You don't need to come out here. I'll be fine.
No, I'm bringing somebody over to talk about it.
All right, then. Well, hey, Daniel?
All right. Yep.
I see a leaping blue. Let's see back around. There's Doe Ball Hickson. You know, surely I can get Doe Ball Hickson over here to come tell us a story about him. If he doesn't have one, he'll make one up just so he can get a free scotch. He doesn't care.
Yeah, you got somebody coming over there right now to talk with you.
Yeah, I'm sure I do, and I really needed that.
Yeah, he's got a...
I thought I was out of that for an hour, and it seems like it's just right back where it belongs.
You can run, but you cannot hide.
You got that right. Hey, while we're talking, I had Ron Moore out here. I was trying to get him to... he just wandered off. You know him, he loves the radio, and he just kept going. I guess there's food in there. I don't know if there's hot dogs, but I thought, well... I could ask Ron if they're doing good sports or not. Maybe he knows. We could at least promote our show tonight, Good Sports. We have other folks. I'm just waiting for somebody to come over and help tell a story about Doug Gearing. If anybody wants to come tell stories.
I think I see a guy coming to tell a story right now.
No, I don't need any. I don't need the stories.
Sorry, he's got something stuck in his ear. Looks like a hazard flare.
I applied for this job to get up here. And now I got to listen to that little rant. Oh, we have somebody coming over here now. Well, you just want to feel sorry for me? Get on that mic. And not only that, I'm a lady over here. Go ahead and yell at me.
Well, thank you for referring to me as being young. That's real sweet of you. I appreciate that.
Well, you got to yell real loud. We have real bad equipment.
Oh.
And I don't know if they can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's how you got to talk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Just like you're a rock star on Rock the Voice.
Yeah, like I'm on stage doing my high school play.
Yeah, what's your name?
My name is Jean Mabry.
Jean Mabry. Now, how are you?
Jean Mabry. Yeah.
Now, how do you know Doug Gearing?
Well, to tell you the truth, we never met the man.
What?
It's true. So, we're not really crafting this affair either. In fact, we were invited by a good childhood friend of his, Ann Jones.
Oh.
And we recently moved here to Cleveland, Tennessee from Oklahoma. And I found Ann on the internet. As an interior designer, and she has done lots of beautiful work for our home since we recently moved here to Cleveland.
Okay.
Ann was over at our house last night, kind of checking out the work that she's been doing, design work.
She was telling you about the big party for Doug Gearing.
She was telling us all kinds of cute stories about Doug Gearing, and she invited us to come, and we thought, well, we would just come here to support Ann and also to hear some more fun stories about this colorful character you told us about.
That's true. And I'm so glad you did. My first guest out of all these drunk old guys, and I get the good-looking woman to come sit with me, and I'm happy. Here, do you want my other beer? I'm not drinking it right now.
Well, I'll tell you one cute story that Ann told me about this gentleman.
Get on there and talk real loud. Okay. We got Margaret. They're telling jokes.
Here's my favorite Doug Aaron story.
Okay.
Doug Aaron bought over a Christmas gift for his friend Alan Jones over to his home. And it was like a big round cask of a thing with wrapped up in paper. And he unwrapped it. And there were holes poked in the top of the can. And so they knew immediately that there was something down inside this big can that was alive. When he pulled the top off of it, it was a boa constrictor.
A snake, or as Mando would call him, a boa constrictor.
Boa constrictor? Yeah,
constrictor.
Constrictor.
So it was a snake.
It was a snake.
Yeah. And I think it almost ate his pet squirrel.
Ooh.
But anyway, yeah, Doug had a way of gifts that only they keep on giving.
Okay, well, here's the fun part of the story that just had us in stitches laughing so hard. One morning, Ann had had a sleepover the night before. And she and her friends were, curled up in the bed early, sleeping. And they wakened to see this snake on the bed.
I've heard that story before, but...
And she said the snake was, like, looking at him, and it had its head up, and it had its little tongue going in and out.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
it
boy.
But it was funny. But.
And he always remembered getting that gift from Doug Aaron.
Yes, and he got that gift from the illustrious Doug Aaron.
I have a feeling Doug probably got that for him, and then his parents said, you better get rid of that.
So Doug said,
oh, I bought it for Christmas.
Oh.
I'm just saying I had a feeling.
Oh, what
I was too young to remember that.
Well, I'm surprised that Alex Wall let him keep it. I might have said no.
This must be Mr. Mabry over here bringing you a glass of wine.
Yes, this is Mr. Mabry. Yes.
Well, there goes Spider.
Well, I hope that
I can't tell who it is or then they'll know. Hey, look, there's Mr. and Mrs. Coat. I wonder if Sylvia, thank you, Jean Mabry for the story. And the sad part is she's the first one that's come talking about a story about Doug Aaron, and she doesn't even know him. Now here we have Sylvia Coach. You guys remember Sylvia, basketball queen, sports star. Even after knee surgery, we're still going to have the horse. I wish there was somebody listening that knew that when you're on a radio program, the microphones pick up and nobody else can hear what's going on.
I'm here to talk about Doug.
Hey, Daniel, if you can hear me, please kill the mics in there, please. I got Sylvia Coach out here. Sylvia, tell us about something about Doug. Now, this is the early show, so there could be family listening. So if you want to come back later and tell the other stories, you can.
I don't have any bad stories about Doug.
Oh, okay. Well, what's the story you know about? You remember?
English teacher, my very first year teaching at Cleveland High School. I taught him 12th grade English. I wasn't too much older than those kids. I was probably 22, 23.
Wow.
And they were 17, 18, and 19.
Boy, I'm glad I didn't have 20-year-old teachers when I was 17. Well.
The thing about Doug, they had to pass my class to graduate.
I'm kind of getting to my guys making more noise than the crowd out here, and I can't hear what you're saying, but I hope our listeners can hear. Yeah, we're on the air, I think. Hell, we don't know. Nobody will go out in their car and see if we're even on the air, so we really don't know if we are on the air. But we're hoping we're on the air, and so loud out here in the studio, in this foyer.
You're
I don't
on the air.
Know what's going on. But, as far as we know, we're on the air then. There goes Toby. Oh, he's in there drinking. Now they're looking for Randy. They're afraid he's out here drinking liquor and not supposed to be. But he's in there hiding in the liquor room.
You want me to talk about that?
Go ahead and talk about those. Now that we can hear you, go ahead.
Okay.
Yes, I can hear you. Yes,
class.
You guys would be.
Yes, I can hear my
guest.
To pass
yes.
my class to graduate. So he worked very hard in my class. The thing I liked about him so much, he had a very dry sense of humor. So it was very easy for that to be like smart aleck instead of respectful. So we had a few issues with that. And then I learned he had that sense of humor like my husband has, who is from New York, and it's very dry. So I knew how to handle him. And I thoroughly enjoyed having him in fact, on your show many times over the years, he mentioned me and how much he enjoyed my class and how much I helped him.
Well, I knew it couldn't have been the athletic part that he enjoyed. It was the English part.
No, I never mentioned playing sports. They didn't even know I played basketball unless they knew it without me telling them, because
right.
I never, ever brought that up in class. People like Alan probably knew it.
And we've never announced what your nickname was over there, because I never wanted anybody to know.
Secret. When I talked to you.
Okay. All
right. Doug talked about English all the time. For years, he said, you know, I really enjoyed English and Miss Coates, Miss Vitercoats, he called you. Talked about just really enjoying English. And we would sit there, we'd talk about English class all day long. We just enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I had you. He had you. Now, who was better, he or I?
Oh, boy. Well,
me or him.
I'm sounding disrespectful. Since one of them is dead, I'll say Alan was.
Now, wait a minute. I know him, and if he was better at English, I don't know how either one of them passed your class. I don't know.
Jack had probably more interest in it than Alan did, because Alan was very athletic and into football and wrestling. So I guess Doug was more attentive than Alan was, but they were both good students. Both, I like fun students that are smart, so they would fit in that category.
Yeah.
Is there anyone else who's going to talk today?
You're the first one to come up and talk that actually knew Doug. Nobody else has been wanting to talk on the radio, and I've been talking solid for 20 minutes, so I'm glad you came by.
Oh, I saw him. They had a 45th reunion at this very place. And
yeah.
The last time I saw him, he was sitting at a table right in there.
Yeah.
He was sitting at a table, had a beard. He drank
Oh, yeah.
Beard.
Let me guess. Did he have on overalls?
It looks a little country.
Yes, I've never seen him without overalls.
And I had not seen him in years, and I asked some of the students, I said, which person here is Doug Guerin? And so they pointed him out to me, and I went over to his table, and we chatted a little while, and I told him I appreciate all his kind remarks about me.
Over the radio?
And I was proud of all the things he accomplished, because you wouldn't have thought he would do all the things he did after he got out of school.
Yeah.
He was smart, but he was an engineer, and he knew everything about the cranes, because my husband has an interest in the cranes, and he would talk about the cranes.
Doug was like, you know, it's like one of these guys that kind of, he learned to build things and do things, like, around, he'd go over to his house, and he had, like, stuff in the garage, and, you know, like, anvils with melted stuff, and is making things, and, like, somebody brought this, he said, Alan Jones brought this thing over here, this ship in a bottle, you know. And this was back before you bought those fake kits, you know, where you just open it in, slide it in, glue it, and shut it, and put it on. I made that. Well, hell, he made them without telling you, without breaking the glass and all that. So he brought that in there, and I remember he made that for Alan.
He gave you the
impression. You handmade it up.
A hoarder, you know.
Oh, yeah, we did. Yeah, we found that out.
He was a hoarder.
His brother was telling me this after he passed away, that they were over there at his house, and they were finding stuff, you know.
All right.
No telling what all in the basement. People were afraid to go down there, I think.
I think Doug was just Doug. He didn't really care what other people thought about him. He was always himself in any kind of crowd, any kind of group. And I guess that started when he was a 12th grader.
Yeah.
Because he stood out because he was just himself.
I can remember the one thing he taught me was how to sit on our, we had a brick wall about 7 or 8 feet tall around our carport, and he would sit out there and wait for me to come out to play with me or whatever, take me out and shoot guns or throw me in a cave or whatever, and he would sit, and I was, what's he doing? And he would spit and let the spit come out of his mouth, and it'd go all the way down, and he could suck it up. And sometimes it would almost hit the ground, and somebody would, and he had the record for that, spitting the most.
See, that's
the one thing I remember.
I didn't see that in my class. I just see this little guy.
I see Amy Jones over there. She grew up. She knows what I'm talking about.
She probably
with you. Wait a minute. We got Randy Jarrett out here. And you say Randy was in your class too?
Don't ask me where he sits.
Yeah. How did he sit at the desk? How could you see him when he was? Did he have one of those chairs like they have at restaurants for children? How did he sit up high enough to?
I brought a little bumper seat for him every day.
Okay. All right. Well, Sylvia coaching. Okay. Doug Guerin's senior English teacher, 12th grade English, and 22 years old. Now, can you imagine being a 17-year-old kid and having a 22-year-old female with long legs as your teacher? I don't know what they...
My teacher... She was my, you know, speech class.
Thinking about Amy Jones, my teachers were like 90 and weighed 400 pounds. Of course, they were probably 24. But they seemed like 90 to me. They were, might as well, they were out of my reach.
Oh!
You know, I grew up on 21st Street, too. I was there when the Jones lived down there. I remember Mr. and Ms. Jones pushing Alan around.
And my older sister Cam was probably running around.
Like sisters, I think.
Older brother Larry.
We loved your yard because we came up there to play ball all the time.
Oh, yeah.
And rode ponies. They brought the ponies out for everybody.
Yeah, well, we always had ponies.
And your sister and I used to get mysteries. We read Nancy Drew mysteries, and we knew there were some mysteries in your house.
Oh,
that was the old house.
Oh, that was the old, ugly,
very
scary house.
Fascinating, though.
Yeah.
It was unusual.
Luckily, they bulldozed that before I was born.
When I was in high school, we came to the house you have there now, the Lambda Sigma Club.
Oh, club. Fancy, I
book
bet.
Club.
Fancy. Had coffee and cake and tea.
I remember there was a pool table in the
house. Oh, yeah.
I remember Rudy Byer and Kenneth Miller and Ron Nathan and all them playing pool.
Yeah.
Well,
you know, Ken Miller, he's not here, but, you know, Ken Miller was rumored to have gone out and dated my sister back in the day in high school.
They were all in a group.
And when my mother had me, it was kind of embarrassing because nobody that old had ever had a kid, I guess. You know, when you have a senior in high school and then there's a little born baby, well, everybody thought, well, her mother is pretending like it's her baby to cover her and Ken having a baby, you know.
You
so I was supposed to be the illegitimate son of my sister and Ken Miller.
I never heard that. The reason, probably, when I was in high school, my junior year, my mother had remarried, and she had a baby. I had a baby sister.
Yeah, that door.
All of us were so naive. Nobody even knew my mother was pregnant. We just thought she got heavy. So one day I came into school and told the other basketball players that I had a baby sister. He said, where did you get that from? I mean, we were too naive.
Well, that's what they said about my sister.
But I never heard your illegitimate story.
Well, I don't know. It might just be a better story than reality. I don't know.
You think anybody else is going to come in to talk?
Yeah, I'm trying to. If you go out there and get you a, have you a drink or get you a snack. They got stuff in there. And then we're going to get Sylvia to wander around and help go, you didn't have a chance to socialize. You just came over here to help me out, and I appreciate it.
We have to go to a football game. Our grandsons have a football game at 6.
Oh, well, you got to see, it's the perfect little pregame entourage.
You did?
Well, go say hi and mingle and have a good one, and good luck at the game.
I really like Doug Guerin. I thought he was a very unique person, bright, and he was a true individual.
Sure. That's why we're here.
Kind of like Pro Daddy is.
Yeah, kind of like Pro Daddy. Hey.
About you, too.
Something tells me if when I die, they're not going to do all this. They'll just get another DJ.
Your sister and I will try to plan something special for you.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it. Sylvia Coach there back in the day at Cleveland High School, English teacher for Doug Guerin in the 12th grade. She was 22 and he was 17. And poor thing, he probably went home every night all upset and, you know, couldn't sleep at night. Who knows? All right, bye-bye. There we I'm not going to say where they call her Spider for some reason. Still because we had Gene Mabry earlier. I got somebody else that I think wants to come up here and tell a story about Doug Guerin. There's Doe Ball. Oh, we do have somebody else coming up here. Let's see who we got here, sir.
My name is Jim Berger.
Jim Berger. Are you a Clevelander?
Yes, I am.
Is this from the old Berger music family that I am?
Yes, it. Yeah. Berger, the whole bunch.
Yeah? Now, how do you fit in with that Berger gang? There used to be a Berger music store right here
in the old... That's my second cousin. I guess it's Richard Berger.
And he was he had the kids that did the music, Clinton and Anthony.
Well, I think he did, but I don't know how, I wasn't really that attached to them.
Berger music, you gotta get right on this damn thing.
But,
we have incompetent equipment here.
He was my second cousin. He's my dad's first cousin.
Because there's still a Berger store in Athens.
I think there is, yeah.
Okay, well, so how do you fit in with Duck Guerin?
I met Duck Guerin at Harvest Stove Company back in the early 70s. He just got out of school. And, he was a technology type engineer, well, industrial engineer. So they hired him in there, and, he's quite kind of a unique person, and, about a few weeks into his, stay there, he had a beard, he had a kind of a frizzy hairdo and whatnot, and he set his head on fire. So,
Doug Guerin set his hair on fire before Michael Jackson made it cool.
He came out, he struck a match and stuck his head in the range trying to light the pilot. And, So it's like the Wizard of Oz. There's like a flamethrower came out over his head. His head was blazing there. But he hit his head so many times he put the fire out. But he kept running at me. Have you put it out? Well, he was freaking out. And I would too.
I had
a few times to kind of help him out there a little bit. It was smoking actually. It wasn't burning too much, but. Anyway, shortly after that, after he went to the doctor and had that 1 degree burn taken care of and whatnot, they made a no beard clause for the lab. He couldn't have that beard anymore.
So he started it. He said it's precedent for folks to not have beards, which has probably saved somebody's life not getting caught in a grinder or these people get in trouble around these equipment, lose your arm.
Luckily,
saved somebody else from getting their face blown off. We had that Grizzly Adam people that aren't picturing what he looked like.
That's hair what it looked like.
He was just wild.
It looked when he shaved that off anyway, because it was kind of getting kind of grizzly, so it was nature's grooming job, I guess.
Thereafter, he got his first date.
I'm sorry?
And wasn't soon after he shaved that he had his first date.
Probably.
Yeah, he had that Grizzly Adam look, the crazy hair and the crazy beard.
Was a frugal person. So, we had a dress code. You had to still wear blue jeans and whatnot.
Right.
He had a pair of pants that he would wear in the summertime. That he would cut the legs out of and wear the shorts in the summertime. And he'd wear these pants into the plants. In the wintertime, he would sew the legs back on. And it looked really bad. And we had to go back and forth to the office many times. They said something about it. He can't wear those pants over here. Because it's like, 2-3 stitches held the legs on, but that's the code, I guess.
Hey, he was ahead of his time, see?
He was.
Those are convertible pants.
If he had known about the zippers,
Velcro,
But anyway, they made him go home and change pants out, so he'd meet the code there.
He had to break down by a pair of pants.
That was a good idea, yeah.
It's time when you're that age, you have a job, you have at least one pair of pants for the winter and one pair of shorts for the summer. You got to break down at some point and spend a little bit of money.
He was a unique person. He and I hiked all over the mountains.
Yeah, I remember. He loved it.
From one end to the other, from Cherahela Wilderness, all the way up to above Hawaii. Mountains, we wore those mountains out.
I was telling the story. Those guys used to drag me out, him, Alan Jones, that little gang. And they'd just say, come on, little Renfro, you're going with us. Where we going? It didn't matter. My mother would be just reading the paper. Well, Lord, I ain't back by midnight, whatever. I was 9, whatever, didn't matter. And they'd take me up and they'd rappel me off a ledge to see if it would hold. And then they'd bring me back up and say, well, he's a little older. He's a little lighter than us, but, at least it didn't break. And you didn't get stung by a bee or bit by a snake, so we're going to go ahead and try it.
Yeah.
And they'd lower me down in the caves, make sure it wasn't a rat or a bat, and they'd bring me out, and I'd be like, yeah, it's fine. This is great. And, hey, see if you can walk down there without getting bit. Okay. Yeah, that's what I was for them. I was like the Vietnam War. Remember, they had the guy that, if you got your number called, you had to go first.
Yeah.
And if they had a VC guy, a South Korean working, they made him go. You go first if you get shot, and if not, we'll all go. That's what I was. I was a scout. Whatever. And now I think back, how am I alive?
When I hiked with Doug Guerin, I mean, so many miles. He always wanted to go first. If I tried to get in front of him, he wouldn't allow it.
Because a snake bites the second person.
That's probably it. That's probably something I didn't know at that time.
That's why I went first.
Anyway, we had a wonderful time, and I sure did miss him. I sure did.
Well, he was older than I just remember the little stories of wandering around as a kid in the neighborhood. And, I wasn't driving cars and all that. And had dune buggies all the time, motorcycles. And I just got to go. They threw me in the back, or I'd sneak in and not tell them. I'd hide in the back seat and wake up and chill Howie Mountain. They'd be like, what are you doing? We're going to be in trouble. Oh, no, it's Lou Renfro. I don't care if he gets home by midnight. It won't matter. He's just 9. They had things they would do, like go-karts, and they'd put me in it and run it down the hill, see if the brakes work. And all these stories are just hilarious. But, that's what I remember most about them is I was the guinea pig. But if I survived that, made me tougher.
Is that how you got the name Bad Actor? He told me it one time, but I don't remember what it was.
I just think it was from calling in on the radio. I was going to say, I hadn't seen him in all those years, but I'd seen him around, and And he, you know, he did really, he was just kind of retired. He, you know, he didn't get out much, and he was in kind of bad health for a long, you know, couple years. Well, he learned about me doing the radio show, so it kind of gave him something to do. And he, if I was doing a contest, and I'd say, you know, how tall is Chilhowee Mountain? And he'd call very first person. I said, everybody but Doug Guerin is able to win this new T-shirt, or whatever, or pizza, or whatever. And then he would call in and give me the answer, and I'd have to take him off the air so nobody heard him. I'm like, damn it, Doug. You know, he would call in and give me a riddle or a guess of some sort of something around here about a whooping crane. Then he'd call in with the answer. Yeah, he's like, Doug.
Yeah, I was at his house when he did a lot of that.
He just came out. Well, we're notorious for when people call in, they're scared to call in because they're scared I'll say something about them.
Yeah.
So they come up with a radio name. So we, and even if I kind of figure out who it is, I never tell anybody. And so that way we can talk about their ex and their wife doesn't know who they are. You know, whatever. So he just came up with, I said, hey, caller, and who are you? You know, and I knew it was Doug Guerin. He just said, I'm Bad Actor. So ever since then, he was Bad Actor. We don't really know why.
Yeah, he always would speak on the radio. And I think he did for a while.
Oh, yeah.
Every now and then, you'd let him.
We even found out where his sister Kathy had taken, you know, when he gotten kind of bad, and it was kind of hard doing it for himself. You know, he lived alone. And she took him back to Selma, Alabama.
Yeah.
And lived with her there until he died. And he would be so excited when we would call him. We found out his cell phone, that he could get through to him, you know, down there. And he was so excited. I never could get through to them that, you know, he can go on the internet and hear our show every day, but they just never did do it.
I never could get to him on the cell phone. I had his number. I still got his number.
You know, I deleted it out of my phone.
Something was wrong with the connection. It was always that way.
I think he just ended up losing that phone, you know.
So I lost him in those last 2 years when he had that stroke. I never could see him before, and I never could find out anything about him. But his brother told me he passed away.
I had two cell phones on him. You know, he got one, and then 2 or 3 years later, he had a different one. So I had his name in my cell phone twice, you know, bad actor. And in case I ever called him live, I could call him. And then I got his new number, so I had him in there in my phone. And it's fun, you know, it's weird, but it's like, you know, I don't accidentally call it or text somebody, you know, when he passed away. And just yesterday, or day before, I went in and deleted his name. It was really weird. It's like, it's kind of hard. You don't want to do that.
Yeah, but
I'm afraid I didn't want to accidentally call him, like his sister answered, you know, or accidentally send a text, and you're like, oh, God, I didn't mean to do that.
I know what you're being.
So I just said, you know, it's just better to delete it and not make that mistake. And that's just hard. I've done it before for other folks. It's just a weird, you know, it's like the final thing. You don't have it in your phone anymore. But
I know.
Yeah, it's terrible. And, well, Jim, thanks so much. Jim Berger talking to me about
no
story about Doug. That's funny. Now, where did you grow up?
In Cleveland.
I mean, what area? He was on Harrell Avenue his whole life.
Yeah, I was on the south end of town, down on
Charlie Highway.
Where I grew up was. It's in the middle of town here, over on 9th Street.
Okay.
And that's where I grew up at. But when I got married, I moved down on Red Hill Road, down the south end of town. And that's kind of where I met up with him. And we hiked around and did all kinds of adventures all the time. It probably just about broke up my marriage.
But if they don't understand
something
that.
Different. And,
yeah.
So anyway, well, anyway, glad to talk to you.
Well, those kind of days are gone. It's sad, you know. Those days are gone. Having folks like that around are gone.
Yeah.
You know, not just Doug, but
I've never had a friendship that long before.
No,
and
nobody's ever going to have that. I mean, there's no subdivisions anymore. There's no neighborhood.
That's it.
You know, everybody just, yeah, whatever. We can get on the internet and we play on our little phone. The kids don't even leave the house.
My grandkids, I worry about them. That's all they do is put a bang on one of these.
Yeah.
Well,
people grow up in these fake neighborhoods. You know, where you,
what neighbors are.
These people right here, they mow down a couple of trees and they plant 8 houses in there with on a tenth of an acre, and nobody knows their neighbor. Even though they live one foot apart.
That's it.
You have to put shingles up to keep from looking at somebody's bathroom, you know? And we didn't grow up like that. We grew up, just running in the woods and ride your bike. Now, if somebody caught an 8-year-old kid riding a bicycle, they put the parents in jail and put the kid in a foster home.
That's true.
You know, it's terrible. Oh, well. We're tougher then.
I've had a lot of adventures with Doug, and I sure do miss him.
Jim Berger, thank you, man. Relation to the Berger Music family from Berger Music Store, where I bought my first bass guitar and amp down here in the Swiss Alley.
Guitar from
$75. I got a bass and an aunt.
I bought a 12 screen for $100. And I still got it. I bang on that thing about 2 times a week for that many years. But back in the 60s,
I wish I could play a 6 string. There's no way I can play a 12.
I can't play it. I just bang on it.
All right. Give me a burger thing, man. There's another story about Doug Guerin, bad actor. We're just out here. We've had a couple folks come by and tell stories about their stories about Doug Guerin. We got a boat and a boat in a bottle. I'm gonna go ahead and go back to a commercial real quick, then take a little break. And Daniel, if you're there,
I'm there, buddy.
Are you there? Hey man, we're gonna take a short break. Let's put some music or a song or whatever you want to do. And they're doing a speech out here real quick, and we'll come back on here and line up some more folks to tell stories about Doug Guerin. We'll be here till 6 o'clock, folks. Come on down to the Bald Headed Bistro. There's free cold Bud Light in there, if you know what I mean.
Sounds good, buddy. We'll be back with you in a minute.
It's all for Doug Guerin. We'll be back shortly. Stick around. Thanks, Dave.
Doug Guerin, the 1968 Cleveland High School graduate.
Oh, he did.
Trailer for sale or rent. Rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes. Oh, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. Third boxcar, midnight train. Destination Bangor, Maine. Wool worn out suit and shoes. I don't pay no union dues. I smoke old stogies I have found. Short but not too big around. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. I know every engineer on every train. All of the children and all of the names. And every handout in every town. And every lock that ain't locked when no one's around. I sing trailers for sale or rent. Rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. Trailers for sale rent. Rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no boo, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8 or 12 for a bit.
That's meant for going to get old Jim Van Cleve to come around and pick a little bit.
I'm in there, Fro, and you are live.
All right, we're back on the air here at Village Green Town Center. Here at the Fall-Headed Bistro in the Fireside Chapel, I'll call it tonight, here at the wake for Douglas Frederick. Bad actor, Garen, and we just had to take a break for them. They were doing some speeches, and Alan Jones was talking about they had to actually have Doug Garen's ashes here. It's just like having a funeral home, but it's more fun, and there's adult beverages. I have one of the neighbors that grew up, we were talking about Alan Jones' sister, Amy Jones, and she's here, and she said she had a story she wanted to tell us about Doug.
Yeah,
so, Amy, get real close and yell out, because we have some great equipment here.
All right. Well, my favorite Doug Garen story is the summer that we decided we were going to go camping in Reliance. We did a lot of horseback riding. We trailered our horses up there often, but we've never been allowed to camp up there. And my parents, for some reason, thought Doug Garen was just the person to take us to camp overnight, as long as a gal named Billy Gant went with us. She was an employee at the credit bureau.
Well, I think everybody felt safe with Doug.
You felt safe with Doug. And my parents obviously felt that, too. And I suppose they were accurate, because we were completely safe. So we go up, so we're loading up our buddies. And I had a good friend, Lisa Allen, who's the daughter of Dr. Allen. And so she didn't actually have a horse, but she loved to ride. And she rode some with a friend of hers named Cynthia Shealy. So she wanted to go with us, but she didn't have her own horse. We all had our own horses. So she borrowed a horse from the Shealy family, Herb and Cynthia Shealy family. And she didn't just borrow a horse, but she borrowed a registered horse called the POA. And it was really a large pony, but a good-looking, really important, much more important than the ones that we were on. So we go up there, and we have the most wonderful time. And Doug teaches us how to build a corral, how to build a fence to keep our horses in, and then we set up camp. First time I'd ever seen a wolf spider. It appeared on my sleeping bag. That was startling. But anyway, so we all had a big time, and Billy Gant was an employee, like I said, of it was a gal, but she was an employee and with my dad down at the credit bureau, and her husband was in Vietnam, and she just played over. We had a CD player that we could, with batteries. She played over and over the song, "Get Me a Ticket for an Airplane, Don't Have Time to Take a Fast Train." So she played that over and over. She was sad. Her husband was over in Vietnam, and she played that relentlessly, and we were out scattered around looking at the creek and had our corral built, had our horses in there, went to sleep. Next morning, wake up, all of our horses are there. The only one missing is the one that Lisa Allen borrowed. His name was Pete, and he was, like I said, a registered horse, so we looked and looked the entire day. The next day, we didn't want, you know, back then there were no cell phones, so you couldn't call home, and we didn't want to call home because it was kind of against her parents' better judgment, our parents' better judgment, that we'd borrow a horse and go through a lot, especially if we're going to camp out overnight. So we looked and looked. The hardest part of the day was I had double lease on my horse, CW. That's kind of hard to double up. So we looked forever. So we finally gave up the ghost. We went home. Bill the Beast, Dr. Allen, and Sterling Allen, that we'd lost his horse. Well, they proceed the next day to go up there and look. And basically, it was really Sterling Allen. And they looked all day long. Well, they were about to give up. And as they were leaving, they were right there by Webb's store, which was on the other side of the bridge. We were on the opposite side. We never dreamed a horse would cross over that bridge because horses don't like to walk over a bridge because it feels hollow underneath. Well, they were departing, giving up the ghost, thinking, what's this pony worth? We'll have to go buy it from Mr. Herb Shealy, his dad, Cynthia, and they decided to look in one more barn. Well, that last barn there, they opened the door, and there was Pete. Nobody was home at the house. They just led Pete out, put him in the trailer, trailered him on home, no questions asked. To this day, we don't know if Pete crossed that bridge, if anyone's ever been up to a line. The Webb Bridge, right there, that huge bridge. There are not many horses that would cross that unless led across. But it could be that Pete had made that trip before. And I was talking to Herb, he said he might have made that trip.
And he might have walked across the water.
It's possible he walked across.
Because it's shallow.
Well.
And somebody thought they had him a new horse.
But now, yes. Yeah. Somebody, when they got home, was surprised.
Well, it got away. Speaking of Herb, I saw Herb Shealy in here.
Herb could come, and he can tell the other way of that story.
We don't want that story. We need a new story, though,
yeah,
don't we?
Yeah.
Well, that was Amy Jones Banks. Now, what about Richard? Now, Richard won't know when he gets out of there.
He doesn't know those. He doesn't know all the good stuff.
That was way before Richard.
The good stuff with Doug happened early through the years. Those were the most fun years. We had a great time. spend a lot of time going to Dooley's.
Oh, yeah.
Dooley's ice cream.
We
thought Doug just was nice for taking us to Dooley's.
How old do you think I was when he was driving through the intersection and I was standing in the seat? I wasn't even, we didn't have a seatbelt, and he hit a car, and I flew into the windshield, busted his windshield. Yeah, he had to take me back and say, Mr.
Emperor.
I don't know why his face is red, but I think he's bloody.
Here's the funny thing is, I bet your parents let you go the very next day out with Doug again.
What are you talking about? We went shooting guns.
Yeah, okay. Okay, I mean, it was like a danger. It was like
we're
a
alive.
Yeah, we could start telling Laura Tripo stories of things that happened that was just crazy.
That's a whole nother story, yeah.
We had a very good time, and Doug was adventuresome. But I will say this, Doug Guerin had some of the best influence on me as far as learning to love the outdoors, appreciating the efforts it took to get to the great outdoors, maybe going through a lot of, you know, brush, debris, mountains, wherever, to get back to that perfect waterfall. And he was always nice to us. And, you know, Alan's older, you know, it's my older brother's friends. They weren't always interested in Alan's little sisters. But Doug was always kind and thoughtful and taught us about nature. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Well, thank you, Amy. Well, have we got other stories? No.
There are other stories that haven't got up here yet.
Well, I'm looking around to see if you can help wrangle up people, and I'm going to ramble here for a second with the Doug story. We normally have good sports coming on around 6 o'clock, that's only about 5 minutes away. And this little get together, I'm telling you, I don't think it's going to quit at 6 o'clock. I have a feeling this little get together will hang out here for another 30 minutes or an hour at least. There's so many folks here, and especially if there's still beer in that keg. You know, a lot of these guys aren't going to leave when there's beer in a keg. So anyway, this is Fro Daddy, a live DJ from Loop Radio, and we'll go about 5 more minutes. I'll get another story in here. We've got the next guys, the Good Sports guys, are getting ready to go live on their show. But we did want to try to see if we had any more live stories and invite you down. If you're out riding around right now listening to Loop 99.9 FM in your car, drop by the Ballheaded Bistro. You'll see the crowd next door on the other side. Near the Woob radio station. We're in the fireside room of the Ballheaded Bistro with the gate open. You can come in from the outside. There's beverages in here and snacks. Come on in, and especially if you know Doug Guerin, remember the stories. You've heard us talk about it. You know that's part of the Woob family, and any part of the Woob family is welcome here today as well. And we'll be, I'm sure, hanging out here for, I know for sure I'll be here for another 30, 45 minutes just hanging out after we walk the air. Come on down, and boat. What do you call it? You know, remember the pirate ship and a bottle, the ship and a bottle kind of thing, you know, and you buy these things and it's a kid, you give it to your kid for Christmas and they put the, you know, you take the little ship out and you glue it together and you paint it and then you stick it inside this bottle and you glue it to the bottom and then you take the bottom and glue it together and nobody can see where you glued it and stuck it together. Well, Doug Guerin he knew how to do all that before there was kids. And he amazed, Alan Jones to this day has the one he got for a Christmas present or a birthday present when he was probably, you know, 12 or something. And he carried it down here just to say, you know, this was so cool. It made such an impact on him back then. And Doug Guerin was part of these guys. I remember my brother having a boat they had built by hand, and, you know, he didn't have models back then. And it actually would, they took it over to Sullivan's Pond and floated it. And I was just a kid and talking about, you know, I was going fishing, and these guys are going to let a boat loose that they hand-built. I got time for maybe one more good Doug Guerin story, and those are mine. I see there comes Jamie Jones. Do we have anybody else who wants to do a Doug Guerin story? I don't see anybody else. There's Jimmy Park, the mayor. I see Lou Patton. Folks are wandering in now. I'd like to get one more good story on Doug, and there's Ann. Ann, you have a good story on. Come here. Here comes a lady over here going to tell us the story. I was telling the story about the boat and the bottle that Doug was so inventive and creative back in the day. He would make homemade gifts for kids that you think, oh, they're just, yeah, they're not store-bought. And then people have that to this day, you know, 40 and 50 years later, that means something. And folks now are kind of figuring out, and Ann's here. And, of course, her sister Amy was talking earlier about the horse, the lost horse that was miraculous. I'm the Herb Sealy's family horse, And you didn't get to hear the story, but Ann's here. Ann, tell us what. Of course, you got a thousand Doug Guerin stories, but what's a good one? We got time for one good story.
One quick good one I can say. Tell you when I was in junior high school, my very best friend Julie Smith came to spend the night with me one weekend, and the next morning I woke up and Julie was just frozen with the, we were both sleeping in a double bed in my old back bedroom, and she was up against the headboard with the covers pulled up to her chin, just frozen. And I could hear someone laughing and snickering, and then I felt this weight on me when I woke up and I looked, and Alan and Doug Guerin had put a 7-foot boa constrictor on top of us in the bed while we were asleep that morning. We could hear them laughing behind the door, snickering when we woke up.
And we already heard several Crictor, the boa constrictor stories. That was one of the first gifts that he gave to Alan as a kid. You know, of course, the boat and the ball, the snake. I mean, if you gave somebody a snake for a birthday or present or Christmas, now you'd go to jail. And there he was throwing it on top of you guys as a joke, and everybody laughs. Nowadays, the family would be in prison, and, you know, the kids would be in foster homes, and that's so much better for America, don't you think?
Yeah.
But anyway, Ann Jones with another story about Doug Guerin. I see other folks. I've been trying to get folks to come over here. I see Kathy, his sister, and Pat, the brother. Now, these guys still call in, still listen to my show. Now, we used to have the girl, the goat girl used to call in. I haven't heard from her in a long time. But, you know.
You're hearing from us right now.
Well, okay, if you want to tell.
Okay.
I don't tell.
There is another Doug story.
Oh, we got one more Doug story.
I can't remember it.
You know, I was telling earlier about Doug was just one of those guys that just wandered around the neighborhood, and, you know, he taught me how to spit, and, you know, just crazy stuff that nobody teaches that.
Oh, yeah.
Kids now know how to use an iPhone when they're four, but they don't know how to spit. Go ahead. One more story.
He used to take us to Dooley's ice cream all the time because he was older than us and had a driver's license, so he took us up to go to Dooley's ice cream.
I went.
We found out years later he was really taking us just so he could look at Jimmy Tippinger scooping ice cream.
Oh.
Cheerleader Bradley. Poor Doug,
he had girls in a campsite. You know, but he wasn't thinking. He was thinking about getting back and going to see Jeannie at that. Okay, go ahead.
This is just sort of a minor little story. You know, you always try to do something, and you meet new.
And have you been inside the bar?
I haven't had anything to drink.
Let me get you a glass of wine.
Way to give me something, and this was later when I was out of college, and so when he was into birding and birds, he knew everything about birds.
Oh, yeah.
He took me to see the thermals and the hawks and all this, and I never realized what a world was going on above us all the time until Doug took me to watch the hawks and the thermal on the mountain, Lookout Mountain.
And when you say took it to the Hawks, you're not talking about a Hawks game, not a Atlanta basketball game. These are animals that are in nature. That these kids that are listening don't know what you're talking about.
Right.
And that's, you know, I'm upset about that. These kids won't come see me anymore because I get mad because they don't want to go with me fishing, you know.
Yeah,
they don't have time.
Or Doug may pick me up and take me somewhere in Timbuktu. I have no idea where we're going. And then he gets his telescope out. We walk up some dirt road, and we're in the middle of nowhere. He puts his telescope out, sets it up, and then he says, okay, look through that and look straight ahead. And he tells me what part of the tree to look in, and it'll be an eagle's nest. And I'm thinking, how did he know that eagle's nest was there? But anyway, when he's into birding, he made me a, he said, I've got a Christmas gift for you. So he drove me around, and we went to the drive-thru dry cleaners out by Big Lots. And the girl there handed out the dry cleaning went to the drive-thru window. Instead of handing me my dry cleaning, she handed me Doug's Christmas gift, which was a handmade squirrel-proof birth feeder. And I thought it was so funny.
And he made it by hand.
Yeah, and he made it, and But I just thought it was unique. He gave it to the lady where I go to get my dry cleaning. And so next time she comes to get her dry cleaner and had her my Christmas.
Give it to him. He didn't want to give it to you.
No, he had
her. It wasn't that he was too embarrassed. He just thought that'd be a cool way to get it.
Yeah.
All right. Ann Jones, thank you so much. There's so many more stories we could tell about Doug. And all these people down here, they're over there telling the stories. I can't get them to come over here on the radio. So if you know anybody that grew up around the area, Harlow Avenue, 21st Street, that's where we all grew up. And we all knew Doug. And he was older. I mean, he's even older than Alan and them. What, 4, 5, 6 years older? He graduated in
6 and Alan 63.
Yeah. So it's like, you know, 3, 4 years difference. But he was kind of the older guy that had the car first. So he could have got everybody in so big trouble,
right.
But he didn't. He was, right. When he took the girls out, it was to go show them nature, not what we would try to do.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You girls want to get my sleeping bag?
Yeah.
And he would say, here, you can have my sleeping bag because it's cold. Yeah. I'll just sleep over here in the car.
Like a tapping on the horse.
Well, those guys, those chivalry, it may be dead. Anyway, this is Rodaddy. Thank you, Ann. This is Rodaddy. I'm going to throw it back to Daniel in the studio.
Thank you for your work, Fro. Sounds like a good time over there.
Is that a term that I've seen on TV? I'm going to throw it back to the now.
You're a true professional.
Do we still have Tommy and Arnold in there getting ready for Good Sports? Tell them I apologize.
They're gearing up for Good Sports. You guys stay tuned, and it's coming on momentarily.
And if you know what I'm talking about, I'm going to try to hurry and break this down and get out of here and hide before somebody sees me and tells me to do another one.
All righty. Well, you have a good one, Fro.
Delivered from Tarver Distributing, get a cold Bud Light and see my friend. I think you see Bailey and Will Jones up there. They're getting me a beer. I'll be right back. See you guys. Good guys coming up next year on Whoop Radio. This is Fro Daddy saying goodbye from Doug Guerin. Bad at one of our own Whoop family who passed away last Saturday. And we hate to see him go. And there's a lot of good stories over here. We'll be here for a little bit longer. Come on over and say hi. Thanks, Daniel. Going back to you. This is Fro Daddy. See you tomorrow afternoon.
Goodbye. He knew me an offer that I could not refuse. He said if I turn head